This is the SF Productions Podcast Network.
That wonderful TV year, 1991.
From the Pop Culture Bunker, I'm Mindy.
And I'm Mark. You can check out our audio podcast, How I Got My Wife to Read Comics on iTunes, or on our website, sfpodcastnetwork.com. I've collected TV Guide fall preview issues over the years and thought it would be fun to talk about which shows made it, which didn't, and which ones we actually watched. Now, I have to give credit to Ken Reed's TV Guidance Counselor podcast for this idea.
Both the TV industry and TV Guide stepped back a bit from the overstuffed previous season. Six fewer new shows, while TV Guide went back to a single fall TV preview issue. They had four the previous year.
So, starting on Saturday night, The Torkelsons, NBC. An Oklahoma family fights off debt after the husband leaves the family. Apparently, it's a comedy. Connie Ray and William Shallert star. In the second season, the show was retooled and renamed Almost Home, with the family moving to Seattle. The show also moved from film to videotape, while Perry King and a young Brittany Murphy joined the cast. A total of 33 episodes aired.
Nurses on NBC, a second-generation spinoff with progenitors The Golden Girls and Empty Nest. The action takes place in the same hospital where Dr. Harry Weston, Richard Mulligan, works. The show was designed as a vehicle for Stephanie Hodge, who played one of the nurses, along with Arneesha Walker and Jeff Altman. David Rashi joined the cast in season two, then Lonnie Anderson came in on the final season as the hospital administrator, at which point Hodge was gone and Anderson became the star. There were plenty of crossover episodes, of course.
The Commish, ABC. Michael Chiklis stars in this Stephen J. Cannell dramedy about a small New York town police commissioner. He's also a family man with wife Teresa Saldana and son Jack Kak Erickson. What a name. That's Kak Eric Erickson.
Kak or Kaj?
Oh, Kaj. It is Kaj. I got it wrong like three times in a row. So, a blend of police drama and family issues. John Segan, later Melinda McGraw, then back to Segan, played his lieutenant. The show ran for five seasons. It was originally planned to air on CBS, but a disagreement with Cannell forced the network change. Two TV movies followed the series run.
PSI, Love You, CBS. This awkwardly named crime drama starred Greg Evigan as an undercover cop and Connie Selica as a con woman. She agreed to also work undercover to keep out of jail. The pair posed as a husband and wife working for Earl Holloman at his detective agency, but it's still a police operation? TV Guide noted that Selica can't pull off a Bronx accent. The show is set in Palm Springs, and Sonny Bono, the actual mayor at the time, made appearances. This Glenn Larson production lasted all of 13 episodes. By the way, the awkward show name referred to the PI's phone number, 774-5888, or PSI Love You.
Moving on to Sunday, The Adventures of Mark and Brian, NBC. Real-life local shock jocks Mark Thompson and Brian Phelps star in an early reality-slash-prank show. Well, it worked on radio, but not so much on TV. Despite having the NFL as a lead-in, the show sank, and most of the episodes were burned off in the next summer.
Erie, Indiana. That's one we recognize. Mm-hmm. On NBC, a bizarre comedy drama from the makers of Unsolved Mysteries, starring Marshall Teller as a 13-year-old investigator in a creepy Midwestern town. Justin Schenkerow played his buddy. The pair kept running into weird people and events, like a woman who kept her twins stored in vacuumware every night to keep them young. The rest of the family and the town had no idea this was all going on. The show wound up first on the Disney Channel, then Fox's Saturday morning lineup, along with a rebooted series later. The original run was only 19 episodes.
Man of the People, NBC. James Garner returns to TV in the show about a grifter that ends up in city council after the death of his ex-wife. He continues scamming while helping his new constituents. Kate Mulgrew played the mayor. This 30-minute sitcom lasted 11 episodes with two more unaired. Garner called the series short-lived, and rightly so.
Pacific Station on NBC is a Barney Miller pastiche starring Robert Guillaume as a veteran cop assigned to a crazy precinct near Venice Beach. Richard Libertini, Megan Challenger, and Rob Liebman played the other cops, with Joel Murray as the lead detective. It ran from September to October, then pushed back to December, before ending a 10-episode run with 3 more unaired. Guillaume would return to series TV almost a decade later for Sports Night.
Rock on Fox. Charles S. Dutton stars as a Baltimore garbage man dealing with his family in what began as a traditional family sitcom. Ella Joyce played his wife with a younger brother, Rocky Carroll, and father, Carl Gordon. As all of the cast were primarily stage actors, the star wanted to move the show to be aired live. After a tryout the previous year, season 2 aired live each week. This updated show would begin with a monologue from one of the cast speaking directly to the audience. This experiment, the first scripted show since the 50s to go live an entire season, only resulted in a minor ratings bump. Apparently, the actors were so professional, 3 of them had just completed the stage run of August Wilson's The Piano Lesson, that it didn't feel live to the audience, aka they didn't screw up. So the show went back to tape in season 3. The show was critically acclaimed, but never did well in the ratings.
I don't think I watched it.
Nope.
Herman's Head on Fox was a surrealistic sitcom about a Greek chorus of personalities inside the mind of the lead, William Ragsdale, a fact-checker for a magazine. He seems normal on the outside, but there's a constant struggle in his brain. Angel, Molly Hagen, represents sensitivity. Animal, Can Hudson Campbell, represents lust. Wimp, Rick Lawless, represents anxiety. Genius, Peter McKenzie, represents intellect. Jealousy, Bobcat Goldthwait. And God, Leslie Nielsen, make guest appearances. They all appear in what appears to be a large attic filled with stuff from Herman's memories.
In the real world of the show, The Simpsons' Hank Azaria and Yardley Smith play his buddy and a research assistant, respectively. Jane Sibbett played another fact-checker who would do anything to get ahead. The show never did well in the ratings, but it did run for 3 seasons, with the lead character dying in a car accident in the final episode. Leaked plans for a 4th episode, 4th season, which came from a writer posting on an early BBS message forum, involved switching to Sibbett's head with new personalities.
That reminds me so much of the Disney movie Inside Out. I wonder if that's where they picked up a shadow of an idea for it.
Maybe.
On Monday, there were no changes in the schedule that year.
Amazing.
On Tuesday, we have All Fly Away on NBC, a period drama set in the U.S. South in the late 50s, with the main theme being race relations. Regina Taylor starred as a black housekeeper for a district attorney played by Sam Waterston.
Dun dun!
Just before his long run on Law and Order. Jeremy London and Catherine Harold also starred. The series became more and more intertwined with the civil rights movement over time. The show won 2 Emmys and 23 nominations, but was gone in 2 seasons due to bad ratings. A TV movie wrapped up the storylines. It's often in lists of series canceled too soon. Creators Joshua Brand and John Falsey had already created St. Elsewhere and would go on to Northern Exposure.
Home Improvement on ABC. This mega hit came from the Give a Stand Up His Own Sitcom Factory. Tim Allen plays Tim the Toolman Taylor, host of a cable TV show. He generally acts before he thinks, which gets him into trouble. He's also convinced he can fix anything, which results in physical comedy. His wife Jill, Patricia Richardson, and kids, played by Zachary Ty Bryan, Jonathan Taylor Thomas, and Taran Noah Smith, all watch off to the side.
His show within a show includes Richard Karn as Al, his sidekick, and Pamela Anderson, later Debbie Dunning, as the Tool Time Girl. Tim could always ask mostly unseen next-door neighbor Wilson, the voice of Earl Hindman, for family or work advice. The gimmick was that you saw the top of Wilson's head over the shared fence. The kids grew up and moved out over time. People got married, what you usually see in long-running sitcoms. The show ran for 8 seasons in the top 10 for all of them. It's been running in syndication ever since and can be seen on Hulu and Antenna TV.
Homefront on ABC. Another period drama, this time dealing with post-World War II. Really more of a soap opera, with GIs returning to sweethearts who had found someone else while they were gone, plus racial and union issues. Kyle Chandler, Mimi Kennedy, Tammy Lauren, Wendy Phillips, and John Slattery were just part of the large cast. The show would run for 2 seasons and won a number of awards, 4 Emmys, a WGA, and a People's Choice.
Wednesday, we had The Royal Family on CBS. Red Fox returns to TV as a retired mailman, ready to enjoy life with his wife, played by Della Reese. In what became a TV trope, their divorced daughter, played by Marianne Ada, along with kids, Silver Gregory, Larence Tate, and future Glee star Naya Rivera, decide to move back home. Wackiness ensues. Well, not so wacky. Just a month into the series, Fox had a massive heart attack during a rehearsal. Ironic, since his best-known role of Fred Sanford faked them a lot, and he died later at the hospital. His death was written into the show, and 227's Jack Hay was added to the cast as Reese's half-sister, later changed to her adult daughter. After a promising start and high ratings, the show was gone in 13 episodes with two more unaired.
Teach on CBS. Phil Lewis stars as a token black teacher at a boys' boarding school. Colonel Achilles Alicio, who comes up with these names, Joshua Hoffman, Ken Lawrence Johnston, and Jason Christopher played the students, along with a yuppie played by Jack Noseworthy. 13 episodes were produced, but only 4 ever aired.
Sibs on ABC, a sitcom about sisterhood, not to be confused with Sisters.
Right.
With Marsha Mason, Margaret Cullen, and Jamie Gertz. Alex Rocco played Mason's husband, with The Simpsons' Dan Castellaneta as her ex-boss. Despite the talent involved in front of and behind the camera, James L. Brooks was the exec, the show never caught on. It ran 8 episodes that fall, then 3 more the next spring, with 12 more never aired. Despite this, there was an attempt to revamp it as Related by Birth, minus Mason and Rocco. They just ceased to exist while the other characters moved on. The pilot didn't make it to series.
Good and Evil on ABC. Susan Harris brought us the story of two more sisters, in this case Terry Garr and Margaret Witten. Garr's character was the cold CEO of the family's cosmetic empire, while Witten played a sensitive scientist involved with stopping viruses. Their mother, Marion Seldes, still ran the empire, though. Mark Blankfield, Lane Smith, Seth Green, and Brooke Theiss were part of this large cast for a corporate soap parody. Blankfield's character was blind, and his physical antics got the network in hot water with the National Federation of the Blind. It was a moot point. Only 6 episodes aired, with 5 more were actually produced but never seen.
On Thursday, Pros and Cons on ABC, with James Earl Jones' character from Gabriel's Fire returning, this time in a more lighthearted series. His wrongfully sentenced PI moves to L.A., teaming up with another PI, played by Richard Crenna. Bones' character instantly changed from being dour to almost manically happy, which had to throw viewers. He also married his love interest from the other series, played by Madge Sinclair. At one point, the show's title was even more of a pun. It was going to be called Bird and Cat. Jones played Gabriel Bird, and Crenna's character was going to have the name Cat. 12 episodes and out.
Drexel's Class on Fox. Yet another attempt to make Dabney Coleman, who always played sour, unsympathetic roles, into a big star. Not sure why the networks ever thought this would fly. He plays a guy with massive tax debt, forcing him to take a job as a teacher to fifth graders. Jason Biggs, Heidi Ziegler, Damian Cagnolati, and Matthew Lawrence played the students, while A.J. Langer and Brittany Murphy, there she is again, played Drexel's teenage daughters. Edie McClurg played the principal. The show pivoted partway into more of a standard family sitcom, with the school left mostly behind, but it only ran for 15 episodes.
FBI, The Untold Tales on ABC. Purnell Roberts hosts this early reality series, recreating FBI cases. That's about it. The show ran for a total of 13 episodes over 2 seasons. Sounds like filler for ABC.
Moving on to Friday. Princesses, CBS. Julie Haggerty, pre-nanny Fran Drescher, and former model Twiggy played New York roommates all trying to find their way in life. Twiggy played an actual former princess, hence the show's name. Mad About You's Layla Kenzie played Haggerty's sister. Now, there was a great deal of friction among the actresses, with Haggerty walking off after 4 episodes. Drescher contacted directly the head of CBS programming to recommend a recast, but he axed the show instead. 8 episodes were shot, but only 5 aired. Now, I thought this was interesting. TV Guide said that Drescher's gum-chewing Brooklyn wiseacre routine was wildly overplayed. 2 years later, a version of that same character would become CBS's queen of comedy, likened to Lucy, doing the same bit.
Step by Step on ABC. It's a mainstay of ABC's TGIF from the Miller Boyett sitcom Factory. Patrick Duffy and Suzanne Summers, All Is Forgiven, love ABC. Co-star as a divorcee and a widow, each with three kids. Why do I suddenly see a set of character boxes in my mind? Brandon Call, Christine Lacken, Josh Byrne, and Stacey Keenan, just off My Two Dads, Angela Watson, and Christopher Castile play the kids. The parents had their own child together in the fourth season, standard operating procedure in family sitcoms, with Emily May Young playing her once she's shot from birth to 5 years old in two seasons. The medical term is SORUS, soap opera rapid aging syndrome. Jason Marsden played a boyfriend in Perfect Strangers. Bronson Pinchot arrived as a business partner for Summer's character. In the final season of Seven, the show moved from ABC to CBS, who was trying to build their own TGIF clone.
Brooklyn Bridge on CBS, yet another period piece, This Was the Year of Them, a gentle comedy set in Brooklyn in 1956. The show centers on Alan, Danny Girard, a 14-year-old in a Jewish family. Louise York and Amy Aquino played his parents, with Happy Days' Marion Ross as matriarch Sophie. They're just part of a large cast of relatives and neighbors. The show was well received by critics, winning a Golden Globe, a PGA, and four Viewers for Quality Television Awards, along with 13 Emmy nominations. The series ran for two seasons. The Carol Burnett Show on NBC. She's back for another shot at variety show glory, just on another network. It's literally the same show, except with new supporting players. Richard Kind is the only one I recognize. She even brought her good luck charm Jim Nabors in for the premiere, despite running all of two episodes per IMDb, weeks apart, so really more like specials than a series. It was nominated for three Emmys.
The Ultimate Challenge on Fox. Michael Adamley and Heather Thomas host this early reality show about daredevils and stunt performers that only lasted a few weeks.
Flesh and Blood on NBC. A driven DA, Lisa Darr, wants to find her birth family in this sitcom. In walks redneck Arlo, David Keith, who insists he's her brother. He's actually a con man, dragging his three kids in to live with her. Perry Gilpin, pre-Frasier, plays her secretary. 12 episodes, four of which never aired.
Palace Guard on CBS, a Stephen J. Cannell crime drama starring D.W. Moffat and Marcy Walker. He's a reformed jewel thief. She's a PR chief for a huge hotel chain. They go to a different locale each week and stop a disaster at one of their hotels using questionable methods. Oh, and he's also secretly the son of the Hotel Empire's owner. Including the two-hour pilot, three total episodes aired, with five more left for the housekeeper.
Reasonable Doubts on NBC, a pre-NCIS Mark Harmon and a post-Children of Lesser God Marley Matlin co-star as a police detective and assistant DA. He's all about bust the perps, while she's into the rights of the accused. There's a lot of arguing going on. The show ran for two seasons, with Matlin moving on to Picket Fences and Harmon to Charlie Grace.
So, let's recap. In 1991, out of 28 new series, there were 11 hits defined as lasting more than one season.
The Torkelsons, Nurses, The Commish, Rock, Herman's Head, I'll Fly Away, Home Improvement, Homefront, Step by Step, Brooklyn Bridge, and Reasonable Doubt, with 17 misses for a phenomenal 39% success rate. The previous year was only 26%.
I don't think I watched much TV in 1991.
Yeah.
None of these stick out as things that I particularly watched a lot or loved. What about you?
I was probably watching early MST at that point.
There you go. And he's still watching early MST at this point.
Yes.
So you can check out our audio podcast, How I Got My Wife to Read Comics, on iTunes or on our website, sfpodcastnetwork.com. From the Pop Culture Bunker, I'm Mindy.
And I'm Mark. Thanks for watching.